Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. I would remind members, if they are seeking to ask a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. At question number one, I call Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government when the remaining £46 million of deferred funding from the agricultural budget will be returned.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The 2024-25 budget returns £15 million in capital to provide important support to our rural communities, and the Deputy First Minister has committed to the returning of the remaining £46 million in full in future years. Now, the remaining ring-fenced funds will be returned in full at the right time for specific measures that will help to reform the transformation of Scotland's farming and food production industry. It doesn't impact on the existing commitments or schemes, and the appropriate profile for returning the remaining £46 million of ring-fence funding will be considered as part of future budget process.
Dr. Samson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. That sometimes gives no comfort to all our farmers. At the NFUS conference, the First Minister couldn't say when the £46 million would be returned to the agricultural budget. Since then, the Scottish Government has had an extra £295 million in Barnett consequentials from Westminster. So can the Minister tell us how much of this extra money will be going to repay the £46 million taken from our farmers?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, clearly and honestly, it never ceases to amaze me that the Tory party can come here and make comments about the £293 million, which is actually almost a couple of hundred million pounds less than what there should have been for NFU, National Health Service consequentials. £230 million of that money will go to the NHS in order to counter the cuts that we've already faced.
Members, let the Minister respond, please.
The phrase ring-fence money, that money has already been allocated or will be allocated in the future. £15 million has been returned to the budget. The other £46 million will be coming in future budgets once the Scottish Government can work out its priorities after the savage cuts that have been made by the UK Tory Government.
Supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Does the Minister agree that capital investment is absolutely vital if we're to transform how we support farming and food production in Scotland so that we help farmers and crofters invest in improved slurry storage and to take action to tackle climate-related issues like water scarcity and flooding? And how does the failure of the Westminster Tory government to provide any additional capital for Scotland in the budget affect our plans to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government failed to provide any additional capital funding for Scotland or our rural communities. Indeed, our capital budget is to be expected to fall by nearly 9% in real terms, a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion to 2027-28. Now, in contrast, the EU cap provided a multi-annual programme budget over a seven-year period with flexibility to use capital or resource spend. The UK Government offers only yearly allocations that fail to provide adequate EU replacement funding or commitment on future spend on agricultural support, which requires long-term certainty. We need the clarity and the certainty from the UK Government about future rural funding after 25 right now, because right now we've got no idea whether it will be Tories or Labour. None of them are committing to supporting rural Scotland.
And supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be well aware how appalled those in the farming industry will be at the fact that he is unable to say when the money will be returned to the budget. Is, though, the Minister aware of any other budget being raided in this way within the Government's budget?
Minister.
I think Liam MacArthur is absolutely well aware that every budget has been under pressure because of the savage cuts that have come from the UK Government, and every Cabinet Secretary right across the Government are all trying to find ways to pull their horns in to make sure that we can deliver a balanced budget, as has been done every year since the SNP took government, balancing their budget every single year so everybody's budget is under strain.
Thank you. Before I call the next question, can I just say, this is a kind of question and answer, so when the question is asked, we do listen to what the answer is. Thank you very much indeed. Question number two, Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to its rural delivery plan, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the impact of its housing strategies, including the Rural Housing Action Plan on local rural economies?
Minister Paul McLennan.
Yeah, the Scottish Government's Rural Development Plan will set out all parts of the Scottish Government deliver for Scotland's rural and island communities. The Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands co-chairs a ministerial working group for the Rural Delivery Plan, which has been established to drive activity and ensure a cohesive delivery, and of which I am a member.
Ashley.
I thank the Minister for that response, but I'm not sure that this action plan is in fact delivering for local communities right across Scotland. And if I raise the issue of some hotspot areas in the Highlands, some areas are experiencing extreme pressure due to the levels of second homes. And in some areas, that is actually approaching a level of 60%. 60% are now second homes. That's creating a number of difficulties, as I'm sure members in the Chamber will understand. Difficulty recruiting into public services like teaching and the NHS, as there is quite literally no accommodation for those people. I don't think the current policies are working, so perhaps it is time for the government to consider giving communities the power to decide when the level of second homes is getting to be too high.
Minister.
Yeah, I think there's a number of initiatives underway, and the member will be aware of the recent legislation that gave local authorities ability to look at doubling council tax and also on the second homes discount. I think the short-term lets control area is also an option that's available to each local authority to look at, and they can be specific in terms of what they're doing in terms of that. There's the £25 million key workers fund that's available as well, and Richard Lockhead and I had a round table with various local authorities and employers a few months ago, and we've got a follow-up coming to that to talk around about the support around about that area. There are also economic development opportunities around about the renewables hubs, around about discussions with SSEN and SPEN, for example, around about, first of all, temporary accommodation units, but how we can provide legacy units beyond that as well. So there's a lot of work kind of going on. We're also working very closely with HIE, for example, and SOSE in the south of Scotland, in terms of looking at combining economic development growth with looking at housing opportunities. But as I said, one of the key things is looking at short-term late control areas, which each local authority has the ability to bring forward and be specific in some of these areas.
I've had a request from three members. I hope to take all three if we could have reasonably brief questions and answers. I call firstly for supplementary, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. All talk from Minister McClellan. The house building record of this SNP government has been dreadful, with rural areas away from the central belt bearing the brunt of their failures. Over the course of the 2016 Parliament, the Scottish Government promised to spend £25 million on rural house building, which it failed to do so. Can the Minister can he confirm if the SNP government have finally met this pledge 8 years later, and what further steps will he do to scale up rural house building?
Minister.
Yeah, it comes back, and it's barefaced cheek, I think, of the Conservatives. First of all, the capital budget was cut. The budget.
Members, we must hear the Minister who has the floor. Minister, please resume.
Yeah, if they let me answer. First of all, I think there's a bit of context.
Minister, please resume. See, I really, you know, we're not going to make much progress with this, and the net result of this will be I will be able to call fewer members to ask supplementaries, and indeed may not even get to all the questions on the business bulletin. Minister, please resume.
Yeah, a couple of things. The capital budget has been cut by 10%, as well as you know. There's been financial transactions cut of 62% in 1 year, 62%. 40% more homes are delivered per head of population than England, and 70% more than Wales. The figure that the Scottish Government has got is delivered 10,000 houses over a number of years in rural areas. I touched about some of the areas we're looking at around about short-term and key workers. I touched around about economic development opportunities, around about SSEN and SPEN and how we develop that. So Scotland's got a proud record, and it's outstanding in terms of the delivery record against England as of Wales. But the easiest way, the quickest way to build more houses would be for the UK Government to restore that capital budget cut.
Supplementary, Rosie Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government announced a £205 million cut in real terms to the affordable housing supply budget. However, the lack of affordable housing is consistently raised as a top concern in rural areas and is consistently considered as a cause for depopulation. The Minister knows it's more expensive to build in rural areas. And therefore, can I ask him to reassure me and the Parliament that the promise outlined in the Rural Housing Action Plan to deliver 11,000 affordable homes by 2032 will be truly in rural areas and will be delivered?
Minister.
I think that's a very important point, and the point that the member mentioned, it's roughly on average 20% more in terms of delivering more in rural areas. And we've already seen construction inflation of 20% just in the last year or so. I think we talked about this in previous debates, around about that 10%, which equates to 11,000. In terms of that, I think that's the really important part of it, and 10% being the minimum. I think we clarified that 10% being the minimum. There was action set out in the Rural Housing Action Plan just in last year. First, these actions were about 9 months, then it goes beyond to the medium and longer term. That objective is still there. We're working very closely, for example, around about the opportunities with SSEN and SPEN, around about economic renewable development opportunities. And again, coming back to looking at the short-term accommodation requirements, but longer-term legacy in terms of that. So there's work going on with HAI in terms of how we look at that as well. And as part of the rural working, the rural delivery plan, that also is a really important part of it. The housing drives economic development, the economic development drives the housing, so they've got to work very closely together. I'm very happy to meet with the member to discuss that and specific issues in terms of that. But that's.
Thank you, Minister. And supplementary, Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much agree with Ash Regan in terms of the importance of community groups in resolving the housing crisis. And so many communities have delivered excellent housing developments across the Highlands, proving that. A number of others have approached me in recent days, not least Elgol. And I wonder if the Minister would be open to engaging with these communities in terms of progressing such developments.
Minister.
Yeah, and I think the member raises a very important point. The Communities Housing Trust was awarded near enough £1 million to work to deliver capacity for local communities. I've already met a number of communities in Kate Forbes' area and will continue to do so. Very happy to take up with the member and meet the group that she just mentioned.
Question number three, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports of rising wildlife crime across Scotland.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has always been clear that wildlife crime is unacceptable. We have implemented a number of important changes in recent years to tackle wildlife crime, including increasing the maximum penalties for the most serious wildlife crimes and strengthening the laws around hunting with dogs. Our Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill contains a number of key changes to help tackle incidents of wildlife crime, and this includes the persecution of raptors occurring on some grouse moors. And I would also encourage anyone with information relating to any wildlife crime to please report it to the police.
Liam Kerr.
Yes, with the Scottish Government set to grant additional powers to the SSPCA in the bill that was referenced to investigate wildlife crime, rural communities will still nevertheless expect Police Scotland to have a role. Can I ask the Minister, what research has the Scottish Government done on the impact of outsourcing policing on evidence and convictions, and what impact is this projected to have on the SSPCA's other duties and purposes?
Minister.
The member's talking about a part of the bill that will be decided here on Tuesday, and I'm actually delighted that he's taken such an interest, because the bill that we're actually producing has been right across the chamber. There's been a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, and we're getting to the heart of where this bill is going to be, which is right in the proper place. So I very much welcome and I look forward to seeing them voting for the bill. As far as the SSPCA powers are concerned, they're very limited, and they'll be done in concordat with the police so that they're working together to make sure that crimes that are reported can be progressed slightly further than where the SSPCA have been in the past, but it will still be the police who will do the final investigations.
Question number four, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what cross-government action it is taking to improve island connectivity in order to support measures to increase the population of Scotland's islands.
Minister Jim Fairley.
The very first strategic objective in the National Islands Plan commits the Scottish Government to addressing population decline to ensure a balanced population profile for our islands, and the recent Addressing Depopulation Action Plan sets out how we will work with regional, local and community partners to deliver a sustainable solution to these challenges. Our recently published Draft Islands Connectivity Plan strategic approach paper proposes a vision that Scotland's ferry services, supported by other transport modes, should be safe, reliable, affordable and inclusive for residents, businesses and visitors, enabling transport connectivity, sustainability and growth of islands and peninsular communities and populations. The draft strategic approach paper is open for public consultation until the 3rd of May, and I would encourage responses.
John Mason.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that answer, and I wonder if he would agree with me that the population in Scotland's islands is not just a challenge for the people on the islands, it's a challenge for the whole country and for people even in the cities like myself. And would he encourage young people, as they think about their careers, to at least consider spending some of their time working and living on the islands?
Minister.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree with that sentiment. The islands are profoundly important and positively contribute to our cultural heritage, our environment, our economy and our national identity. Despite the challenges faced, islands are great places to live for our young people. And that's why I would encourage young people to stay within our rural and island communities or to move there as a priority in the Address and Depopulation Action Plan. And as someone who's lived in a rural community, there is a different sense, there's a different feel. It will be different to the way people normally live in a town, but there's a fantastic, there's a community feel in islands and rural communities that I would really encourage people to look at. And that's why we're working with Youth Scotland and Young Islanders Network to consider how to best address population decline through co-developing ideas and actions to support and encourage young people to remain on, move to or return to the islands. We'll also work to increase participation of young people in community councils, to empower young people to inform improvements to services in their area, making rural communities far more attractive places for them to live and work.
A supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The exciting development of Saxeford Spaceport has a vital role in the country's space industry, but to get to the spaceport in Unst, you've got to take two ferries from Shetland's mainland. So does the Minister agree with me that cross-government action on short subsea tunnels between Shetland's islands would improve connectivity and reverse depopulation, as our Nordic neighbours have found with their tunnel projects?
Minister.
I have to say, Beatrice Wishart, that's not something I've heard about, but it is something I'd be very keen to engage her with, and I'm more than happy to meet and talk to her about it after this session.
Question number five, Martin Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is available to farmers who have experienced damage to crops as a result of the activities of beavers.
Minister Lorna Slater.
Beaver burrowing into flood banks can exacerbate flooding in some areas, but in other circumstances, beavers can reduce flood risks. I will be visiting a farm in Perthshire next week with the National Farmers Union of Scotland to discuss the flood damage and how that may have been exacerbated by beaver activity. Farm viability and livelihoods can go hand in hand with delivering for nature and climate. However, this cannot be at the expense of farm incomes. Nature Scot have mitigation measures available, and we are exploring long-term solutions to key issues such as increasing the resilience of riverbanks to flooding events.
I thank the Minister for her response, and she will be aware when she visits farmers in Perthshire, as the Minister beside her is well aware, that there are farmers alongside rivers such as the Tay, the Erne, the Erecht and the Isla who have suffered significant loss due to flooding and damage to crops due to beavers eroding traditional flood banks. Now, it was the Scottish Government that decided, against the wishes of many in the farming community, to reintroduce beavers and give them protected status. So does the Minister accept that this puts a moral obligation on the Government to fully compensate affected farmers for the losses that they suffer?
Minister.
Beavers are native to Scotland, and their establishment will play an important role in restoring Scotland's natural environment. We are looking at how the Scottish Government and Nature Scot can further support farmers to host beavers, and there are opportunities to do this with the upcoming changes to agricultural support. In my visit to Perthshire next week, we will be talking about mitigation plans and what's available for farmers. Beaver licences will continue to be available to deal with serious risks where there is no feasible or alternative for beaver management. Of course, we also do need long-term flood management, which would include things like natural flood management and realignment of flood banks to help mitigate beaver issues.
And supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. I welcome the recent beaver reintroductions in the Cairngorms National Park, which have the dual benefit of facilitating translocation into suitable habitat and providing an alternative to lethal control. Can I ask the Minister what measures are being taken by the Cairngorms National Park Authority to support farmers to mitigate any impacts to their businesses?
Minister.
The release of beavers in the Cairngorms National Park represents a key milestone to ensure beavers as an iconic species and ecosystem engineer can once again thrive across Scotland. The Cairngorms National Park Authority has produced a management and mitigation plan which reflects land managers' primary concerns. The Park Authority's commitment to fund small-scale mitigation activities and remedial works adds significant extra resource on top of the already available national mitigation scheme operated by Nature Scot. This approach has been commended outside the farming sector.
Question number six, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its progress towards introducing its proposed land reform bill.
Minister Lorna Slater.
As outlined by the First Minister in September, the current programme for government includes a commitment to introduce a new land reform bill. While I can't comment on the contents of the bill ahead of its introduction to Parliament, the bill will further improve transparency of land ownership, help ensure large-scale land holdings deliver in the public interest, and empower communities by providing them with more opportunities to own land and have more say in how the land in their area is used.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for that answer. I recognise that many think that land reform is a rural matter, but could the Minister please give us an outline of how the contents of the bill, how that will benefit people in urban settings who want to bring land and buildings into community ownership?
Minister.
We strongly support community ownership for all communities, which is why in 2015 the Scottish Government extended the right to buy to urban areas through the Community Empowerment Act. We have also extended eligibility for the Scottish Land Fund to groups in urban areas. Since then, there has been a steady increase in successful applications from community groups in towns and cities across Scotland. A review of the community right to buy legislation will begin this summer, following introduction of the Land Reform Bill. It will cover legislative and procedural aspects of the community right to buy and will report at the end of 2025.
Question number 7, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with the Health Secretary regarding implementing the commitments contained within the Good Food Nation Scotland Act 2022.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The Ministerial Working Group on Food is the mechanism for cross-portfolio discussions and decision-making on food-related policy at a ministerial level. Health interests are represented on that group by the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health. The Good Food Nation plan has been discussed at all the in-person meetings of this group, and the group has also worked by correspondence to review and approve the consultation draft.
Emma Harper.
Thank the Minister for that answer. The Good Food Nation Act sets out a vision for Scotland to be a nation where people take pride and pleasure in and benefit from the food they produce, purchase and prepare. To achieve this aim, it is vital for the Rural Affairs Secretary and the Health Secretary to work together to support high-quality producers and address ultra-high-processed, high-fat, sugar, salt foods, which are detrimental to health. So can the Minister just reaffirm that the cross-portfolio working will continue to take place, and can she comment on whether the Good Food Nation commitments will be enacted?
Minister.
The Good Food Nation plan reflects the importance of cross-portfolio working to achieve our vision of Scotland as a good food nation. The plan describes the key areas of focus to achieve our vision of Scotland as a good food nation and details the working mechanisms in place to support this. The final version of the plan is due to be published in 2025. However, work continuing to the outcomes is already ongoing. For example, the open consultation on proposed regulations to restrict promotions of food and drink high in fat, sugar and salt is in line with our public health priority to create a Scotland where everyone eats well.
And question number 8, Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to support Scotland's fishing industry.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As set out in the answers to previous questions on this subject, the Scottish Government continues to support and manage Scotland's vital fishing industry in a number of ways. We continue to deliver the actions in our 10-year fisheries management strategy, with an update to the strategy delivery plan due for production later this year. This is underpinned by the funding we continue to provide through the Marine Fund Scotland and the various functions we deliver to ensure our fishing industry can operate sustainably and effectively.
Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Last year, the Scottish Government were asked by the fishing sector to consider a derogation to the North Sea Cod Avoidance Plan to allow fishing for squid inside 12 nautical miles. As the Scottish Government officials themselves recognised in their correspondence with the Fisheries Management and Conservation Group on the 5th of July last year, this is a lucrative fishery and one that can take pressure off net profit grounds. However, no derogation was granted last year, and the industry still hasn't been advised whether a derogation will be granted this year, something they ideally need to know by the end of this month. So can the Minister confirm that a derogation is being considered, and also when a decision on that derogation will be made?
Minister.
The Scottish Government wants to restore marine habitats in Scotland's inshore waters and provide a higher chance of stock recovery and sustainable fisheries in the future. But I understand this is a complex issue with strong views on both sides, and the decision to remove exemptions was not taken lightly. However, the answer to that specific question would have to come from the Cabinet Secretary, and I will ask her to respond to the member directly.
And brief supplementary, Eleanor Whitten.
Thank you. I wonder, does the Minister agree with me that we would be far better able to support all of Scotland's fishing industry had the Westminster Tory government kept their much-repeated Brexit promise to fully replace all EU marine funding?
Minister.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that sentiment. And the figures, I don't have figures right in front of me just now, but what I do know is that the EU funding has grossly been cut by the UK government, and the Scottish fishers were far better off when we were actually part of the EU.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on rural affairs, land reform and islands. And there'll be a very brief pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you. Thank you. The next item of business is portfolio questions on NHS recovery, health and social care. Again, I would remind all members, should they wish to seek to ask a supplementary, they should please press the request to speak button during the relevant question, or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. At question number one, I call Kate Forbes.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with NHS Highland about progressing planning and design work for the new Belford Hospital in Fort William.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Officials met with NHS Highland in January to discuss development of new projects, including the new Belford Hospital. As colleagues will be aware, the Chancellor ignored the Deputy First Minister's call to increase capital funding for our NHS, so we're still facing nearly an 8.7% real terms cut in capital funding over the medium term until 27-28. We will continue to work with NHS Highland to progress where we can in the face of this lack of capital from the UK Government budget, but Kate Forbes will understand the challenge that is before us.
Kate Forbes.
I absolutely understand the challenge that the Health Secretary is dealing with, and indeed the whole government. And he will be aware that at a time of constrained public finances, it's all the more important to use funding that progresses work as far as possible without wasting the funding and the effort that's gone in to bringing the project to this point. And so to that end, can I ask how much money the NHS Health Board has asked the Scottish Government for in order to continue that design work on the new Belford Hospital?
Cabinet Secretary.
So discussions are ongoing, and it's essential that NHS boards continue to plan for how they will improve and reform services, and we remain committed to supporting them in that process by exploring all funding options available to progress projects, as capital projects like the Belford will clearly assist with patient outcomes, productivity, and thereby assist our recovery. The UK Government cuts to our capital budget have resulted in new health capital projects being paused, so we know this remains challenging, as Kate Forbes has alluded to, as many projects under the, around the country are under review, and we're working through this challenge, both myself and the Deputy First Minister. However, colleagues will appreciate this may take some time as we look at all options, and I will do what I can to keep Kate Forbes updated, given her understandable interest and concern.
Supplementary, Tamiko?
No.
Supplementary, Roger Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Fort William is the outdoor capital of the UK, and yet a helicopter taking a casualty from the hills can't land at their hospital. The people of Lochaber have been promised a new hospital for over two decades. Will the Scottish Government make good on that promise?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Rhoda Grant for that question and understand the concern that she comes forward with. As Kate Forbes has articulated, the need for
new hospital here has been set out and made. The issue that we have is, of course, the financial reality that we face, where the costs of these projects have risen with spiralling UK inflation, of which this is not the fault of NHS boards or indeed this government, and a constrained capital budget, where we're seeing £1.3 billion removed from our capital budget up until 2027-28. So the financial reality is that these projects must be reviewed in order that we take forward as many as possible through the review that's underway both by the Deputy First Minister and myself.
Question number two, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the availability of ADHD medication supplies in Scotland.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Various ADHD medicines, a number manufactured by Takeda Pharmaceuticals, continue to experience limited and intermittent supplies, with market data indicating that supplies will stabilise between March and the end of May 2024. The shortages are caused by a combination of manufacturing issues and increase in demand. The pricing and supply of medicines is a reserved matter for the UK Government, and we continue to engage with them on this. The Scottish Government recognises the impact of these global shortages on people living with ADHD and their families. NHS Scotland has robust systems in place to manage medicine shortages when they arise. Anyone affected by this issue should speak to their clinical team.
Rona Mackay.
I thank the Minister for her response. During a recent event I sponsored in the Scottish Parliament, I had the opportunity to meet a young girl with ADHD who expressed concerns about her medication. She shared her experience of having to skip medication days. Can the Minister advise on measures to ensure that no child with ADHD needs to skip their medication days?
Minister.
I thank Rona Mackay for raising this in the Chamber, and I'm sorry to hear about the situation that the young girl that she spoke to finds herself in. A UK-wide national patient safety alert is currently in place for medicines used for the treatment of ADHD, advising healthcare professionals of this shortage and providing information on alternative suitable medication when appropriate. Restrictions have been introduced which prohibit a number of medicines for the treatment of ADHD from being exported from the UK or stockpiled in order to protect supplies. The Chief Pharmaceutical Officer for Scotland is a member of a UK-wide medicine shortage response group set up to identify and coordinate responses to medicine shortages, providing advice to clinicians on alternative therapeutic options.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Secretary. So the shortage of ADHD medication supplies is causing distress for people who have advocated tirelessly to get a diagnosis in the first place. One constituent of mine first sought a diagnosis in 2008 and was finally diagnosed privately with ADHD in 2023, but will shortly run out of the medication she needs. So what consideration has the Scottish Government given to exploring new procurement options for drugs like lisdexamfetamine, given the production issues faced by the current supplier?
Minister.
I thank Paul Sweeney for that question. And I think, as I mentioned in my first question, the UK Government remains responsible for medicine supply. However, the Scottish Government keeps in close dialogue with all health boards to manage the shortage and provide support where necessary.
Question number three, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to a recent report from the Institute of Fiscal Studies, which states that the 2024-25 budget implied a real terms reduction in health spending.
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish budget shows year-on-year real terms growth in health funding when we compare the opening position. The budget document states the opening budget position for each financial year and allows direct comparison with the two previous years. This provides a consistent point of reference for the Parliament and stakeholders. And in fact, the IFS report also notes the real terms increase when comparing on a budget-to-budget basis. The report clearly underlines how important additional in-year funding is to maintaining real terms growth, funding that has directly dependent on the UK Government prioritising additional health investment over the year, something that we did not see prioritised in this budget.
Liz Smith.
Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for that. And I recognise that there are comparisons that can be made on previous years, but the Institute of Fiscal Studies was making the point that the Scottish Government claimed that health spending had increased by 1.3% for 2024-25, didn't actually include the top-up figures for the previous health budget in 23-24. Does he recognise that there is some inconsistency in that, which makes it more difficult to scrutinise budgets?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, as I referred to in my earlier answer, we provide budget-to-budget consistency so that there can be clear scrutiny. I understand, and more than understand, given the pressures that we're currently under, how important in-year consequentials are, and would encourage the UK government to continue to consider the call from international organisations to see investment in public services instead of tax cuts being a priority for this government, because that would then allow us to take forward further increased spending in our health service, which is much needed.
Supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. Liz Smith and the Conservatives seem to imply that somehow money could appear out of the magic money tree to fund the NHS in Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary clarify if the NHS in England is much better funded?
Cabinet Secretary, for matters within your responsibility.
Thank you. Well, it has a direct consequence on the budget that we have in Scotland, the decisions that are taken in the UK government for the NHS in England. And the UK government's own figures show that the Department for Health and Social Care for 24-25 is 0.2% less in real terms than 23-24. So the figures there stand. In contrast, our 24-25 budget provides a real terms increase of almost 3% for the NHS in Scotland as we continue to prioritise frontline public services.
Supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
Patients and staff have been promised state-of-the-art national treatment centres for many years now, specifically to increase capacity and tackle the waiting list backlog. As a result of the real terms reduction in health spending in the forthcoming financial year, the Cabinet Secretary has instructed health boards to halt all project plans. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell the Chamber, now that the NHS recovery plan is in tatters, how he intends to clear the waiting list backlog?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do not accept the premise of Jackie Bailey's question, because she is suggesting that it's decisions that we are making around the capital investment in our NHS that is to the detriment of those national treatment centres. That is not the case. It's a direct consequence of the decisions that have been taken elsewhere, where we have seen nothing in terms of a capital increase to our budget from the spring statement, or indeed from the autumn statement. So that is why these national treatment centres are absolutely important. They are critical to seeing our continued recovery. I want to see them happening, but as I'd said in answer to previous question from Rhoda Grant, there is a financial reality around a diminishing budget coming from the UK government and increased costs. That means that we have to put those projects under review, and wishing it to be otherwise is not enough. We have to get on with looking at how we can fund these centres, which I'm committed to looking at as far as possible.
And supplementary, Peter Swishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What assessment has the Scottish Government made on health spending and the impact of frontline services and patients in rural and island areas, given the higher costs of delivering services to these areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
That is, of course, something that not just myself, as somebody who grew up in an island community, but also this government recognises. We will obviously, in negotiations with health boards, look at what we can do to provide ongoing support for the fact that they have disproportionate costs in delivery of their service, and that remains under constant review on a budget-to-budget basis.
Question number four, Tim Ehoe.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the availability of NHS dentistry for the residents of Dunoon and its surrounding communities.
Minister Jenny Minto.
NHS Highland has recently been successful in recruiting to posts within the public dental service in Dunoon, which is currently providing NHS dental care for priority groups as well as emergency dental care. I also understand that the Board has procured funding to establish a peripatetic service, which is expected to be in operation around Argyll and Bute this summer. The Board has a dedicated dental helpline for patients in Argyll and Bute, which can provide advice on which practices are accepting new NHS patients in Highland and surrounding health boards, as well as further advice and support.
Tim Ehoe.
Thank you very much for that. I do appreciate that there has been some work ongoing. In response to a previous written question on this, the Minister, the Government noted the opening of a new dental practice in Inverness. While that may be welcome for residents there, it is hardly of comfort to residents in Dunoon, which are 174 miles, 4.5 hours away. Several residents are still contacting me about this, though they are deeply concerned. So whilst I appreciate that there has been something that's happened now, does the Minister have other incentives that can help the Scottish Government to offer existing local practices more support so that they can increase their capacity and meet demand?
Minister.
I thank Tim Ehoe for that question. And actually, on Friday, I had conversations with a number of my constituents about the about dentistry within Dunoon and Cowell. I'm Unfortunately, I had hoped that a new dental practice was going to open in Dunoon because there had been an interest in one of the government SDAI grants, which gives £100,000 for a new practice to be opened. But unfortunately, the dentist that previously expressed an interest in purchasing the practice via the grant has advised that they're no longer progressing that. I mentioned the peripatetic unit, which I think is going to make a difference, but the board has also advised me that they continue to seek expressions of interest for the grant and continue to engage regularly with local dental practice owners and dental corporate bodies regarding the provision of NHS dental services for communities in Dunoon and Cowell.
Question number five, Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last received an update on NHS Forth Valley's assurance and improvement plan.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government receives regular updates on NHS Forth Valley's assurance and improvement plan through the NHS Forth Valley Assurance Board, which last met on Friday the 8th of March. Good progress has been made across all areas of leadership, culture and governance, and with a strong focus of evidencing the improvements that are now being made, I'm hopeful and confident that this will lead to de-escalation. Minutes from the NHS Forth Valley Assurance Board meetings are published and can be viewed on the gov.scot website, and a copy of the improvement plan is available on NHS Forth Valley's website.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and I acknowledge that progress is being made and that Forth Valley Hospital performs well in areas such as elective care, and for my part as a local MSP I continue to get a steady stream of very positive messages about the care that people are receiving, and I think we should acknowledge the work of the staff in relation to that. But the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the challenges faced by the smaller health boards like Forth Valley, and can he outline any further measures that the Scottish Government is taking to address this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Keith Brown for that question and his interest, and also for the information that he's been able to pass on there in terms of direct patient experience, which I think is incredibly important. This is indeed a challenging time for us all. I recognise, as Keith Brown has, that the progress that's been made in elective care, the continued difficulties that there are in areas in unscheduled care, for instance, and indeed those challenges being faced on a wider basis by other smaller boards. The government is continuing close dialogue with boards to maximise performance and delivery locally. This is supported by strategic collaboration on financial and workforce planning. Practical measures from an NHS Scotland perspective include mobilising tailored improvement support from the National Centre for Sustainable Delivery, creating additional capacity through the new National Treatment Centres, and targeting both regional and national approaches where appropriate to support pressurised services. But I recognise in Forth Valley's case, improvements have been made. There is more to do, and I'm committed to providing as much support as I can in order to see that continue to happen.
And supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is unclear how required improvements at urgent and unscheduled care at NHS Forth Valley would take place. The picture around psychological therapies and children's mental health was extremely challenging, Cabinet Secretary. So what improvements have been made and what action can we put in place to ensure that these patients are given the care they require?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Alexander Stewart for that question, and I recognise the points that he is making, and reiterate the points I've made in response to Keith Brown around where we have provided support and intervention on those areas. He is right to point to unscheduled care to be a particular area of concern. That is an area of concern that there has been for a long period of time. I'm hoping that in the figures we see come through on the weekly A&E statistics that we will see some improvements coming from Forth Valley, but that is coming from a very low bar, and we need to see a much greater improvement going forward, and my commitment is to try to continue to support them in that progress being made.
Question number six, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it will develop its e-health strategy in the coming years.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I can confirm the Scottish Government's e-health strategy was replaced by a digital health and care strategy that was published jointly with COSLA in 2018 and updated in 2021. The strategy is accompanied by an annual delivery plan, with the delivery plan for 24-25 scheduled to be published in April 2024. However, there are no plans to further develop the strategy itself in the immediate future.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? One of the few benefits of COVID was that we were able to embrace digital technology much more, and which basically came to the rescue in many fields, not least in telehealth. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that we must continue to develop and exploit the power of digital technology within our health service to help us improve things like GP appointment systems, e-health digital consultations and general telehealth services that are crucial especially for people living in rural parts of Scotland, but are just as valuable as a means of improving general access to all of our NHS services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm grateful to Willie Coffey for that question. I do agree. I think it's going to need to be a central point of where we can see reform in health and social care going forward is to further utilise innovation and technology. I agree we should be exploring more opportunities for greater use of digital solutions. Some of this is about maximising the capabilities of our existing investments. For example, the new GPIT system, which we're in the process of rolling out, has the ability for GPs to offer online booking services. We have already rolled out Near Me for online consultations, and some of this, of course, is about exploring the art of the possible. And through the Scottish Funding Council, we've recently confirmed 10-year funding for the Digital Healthcare Innovation Centre to continue leading our efforts to explore where those opportunities are. So I'm grateful for Willie Coffey, because this is an area we're going to need much greater time and resource.
And supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As we attempt to tackle significant issues within our health service, I hear time and time again from our NHS boards that their outdated IT systems are a block to progress. A modern collaboration and communication platform is essential to begin to bring our health service back into a better state, especially in data gathering and the development of our e-health. The Chancellor committed in excess of £3 billion to develop healthcare tech. Would the Cabinet Secretary consider working with the United Government to help bring Scotland's NHS IT systems up to scratch to create a UK-wide communication and collaboration system?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Brian Whittle for that question, because I agree fundamentally with the points that he's raising about the need for that investment. I would gently point out to him that the investment that was announced by the Chancellor is not money that's arriving this year, it's money that's going to be arriving in years to come, where I believe we need that investment much earlier. Of course, we would seek to collaborate where that is possible to ensure that there's effective communications between systems, or indeed in Scotland between the likes of GP services, the acute settings and social care. And that's exactly what the reform discussions that I'm embarking upon will be about trying to direct. But in terms of where the capital comes from to invest in that, I would encourage Brian Whittle to encourage his colleagues to see that investment front-loaded, so we can see that investment now.
And supplementary, Cara Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The rollout of e-health and digital technology is going at quite a slow pace. Recording of patient data still differs from one health board to another, which hinders progress, and some prescriptions are still being written by hand. If we are to develop an e-health strategy fit for the future, we must see rapid advancement in terms of streamlining recording practices across the country, and we must ensure that staff and patients alike are clear on what that progress looks like. So could the Cabinet Secretary outline in any future e-health strategies how we might address those concerns?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Carol Malkin. Again, I agree with the premise of her question. I think she's absolutely right. For us to have a productive health service, one that is responsive to patient need, and also ensures that our clinicians are able to communicate effectively between boards, in some cases where that is necessary, or indeed between different settings, primary, acute, social care, for instance, then that cohesion and coherence is necessary. We are already making investments. I take the point that Carol Mochan is making about the pace of that. We want to go faster. We look at interest with the capital investment that is to come in future years from the UK government. We would want to see investment come sooner, and I'll continue to collaborate with boards, with colleagues around how we can develop that the digitisation of our health services in a faster process.
Question number 7 is from Monica Lennon, who is joining us remotely. Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on NHS Lanarkshire's recovery plans.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Monica Lennon for that question. NHS Lanarkshire, along with all boards, produce annually updated delivery plans setting out how they are addressing the challenges set out on our NHS recovery plan. Boards are currently in the process of developing their updated plans for 24-25, and once finalised, NHS Lanarkshire's will be published via their website. These plans set out how the board continues to address significant ongoing pressures with COVID backlogs, delayed discharge and Brexit-related staff shortages, compounding the pressures on already stretched services. So I offer my continued thanks to NHS Lanarkshire and their staff for their ongoing dedicated effort during these challenging times.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response and also put my thanks to staff on the record. Can he advise whether the downgrading of Wishaw's neonatal intensive care unit will help or hinder NHS Lanarkshire's performance, and whether, in his assessment, this plan will be good or bad for the babies, children and families of Lanarkshire?
Cabinet Secretary.
This is, I think to be clear, this is not a downgrading of Wishaw General Hospital's neonatal unit. This is about ensuring that we're providing the specialist services that those particularly sick babies need in a safe way. My colleague Jenny Minto visited Wishaw General Hospital recently, was able to see the progress that is being made there, and obviously we will continue to engage with staff and with patients to ensure that the understanding of why this is necessary, which has been led by clinical advice and evidence, can be taken forward. And I'll ensure that Monica Lennon has that advice to her, either from myself or Ms Minto.
And question number 8, Sarah Boyan.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of the progress it's making towards fulfilling its 2017 commitment to increase the number of GPs by 800 within a decade.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I remain fully committed to increasing the number of GPs in Scotland by 800 by 2027. I welcome the fact that the GP headcount has increased by 271 since 2017 and is now consistently over 5,000. Training new GPs is is key to our approach. This takes time, but we have expanded GP specialty training, adding 35 places this academic year and a further 35 places next year, and there are currently just over 1,200 trainee GPs in Scotland. We are also investing over £1 million each year in recruitment and retention initiatives, and I will set out my plans to further increase GP numbers in due course.
Sarah Boyett.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but say I was very concerned when I met with a constituent who works part-time as a GP, and his view was that because GP services are not given financial support to have trainees working with them who are future doctors, that this means that those GPs potentially are missing out because those trainee doctors don't see the fantastic contribution that GPs make to our health service. And he wanted me to highlight directly to the Scottish Government that lack of funding which doesn't apply to hospitals. So I wonder if the CabSec would review that issue and consider whether it could make a big impact.
Cabinet Secretary.
In principle, yes. Sarah Boyack will be well aware of the financial pressures under which we're operating. But in principle, I'm more than happy to look at that. I'm more than happy to hear more from Sarah Boyack's constituent to hear about how we are able to see the resource going into primary care being increased. And part of the reform consideration is about that prevention, about ensuring people are using primary care in a much more effective way. And so I'd be happy to meet with Sarah Boyack and her constituent to hear that directly.
Supplementary, Sanjish Gohani.
GP shortages are particularly acute in Scotland's Highland, Island and rural areas, and doctors are quitting. And we now have some rural practices wholly staffed by temporary locum doctors. This is worsening health inequalities and depopulation in these areas. The shortfall of GPs has been described as critical by the BMA, and they have called for special measures to be put into place to reverse the crisis. Golden hellos clearly aren't enough to address the issues, and current schemes are also not delivering enough GPs. We need urgent action to properly tackle the root problems of the failure to recruit and retain GPs. What urgent action is the Scottish Government doing to address this crisis in rural and island communities now?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I've already set out in response to Sarah Boyack's question the work that we're doing both in investing in recruitment and retention worth £1 million a year and what we're doing to provide increased numbers of people, GPs in training. We're currently sitting at 1,200 GPs in training. We'll look, obviously, I'm looking forward to meeting with the BMA and hearing more about their suggestions as to how we can continue to facilitate that recruitment and retention, but doing so within a financially constrained environment where decisions taken for us, both in terms of workforce, the impact that Brexit has had, but also the impact that diminishing resources resources coming from the UK government clearly have an impact in terms of our ability to invest in the reform that we need.
And brief supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that training new GPs will play an important part in increasing the number of GPs in Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding what further steps it's taken to support people to train, like the unique ScotGem programme, which does have a focus on rural recruitment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, indeed, a good point there from Emma Harper. She's absolutely right. And recruitment into general practice specialty training programmes in Scotland has improved drastically in recent years. Of all the GPST posts advertised in 2022, for example, 99% were filled successfully, up from 64% in 2016. 100% fill rate has been achieved in Scotland for the first time this year, based on data that was published in July 2023. And end-year results will be published shortly and will confirm the final position for 2023. And we are funding ongoing expansion in GPST with 35 additional posts created last year, another 35 being added this year. In addition to increasing training numbers, we recently submitted and committed to investing £1 million into targeted enhanced recruitment scheme bursaries for GP trainees who agree to undertake training in traditionally hard-to-fill areas, including remote and rural parts of Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on... Sorry. Point of order from Dr. Cahalan.
Apologies, Deputy Presiding Officer. I didn't declare my interest in practising NHS GP.
Thank you, Dr. Cahalan. That will be duly noted. Obviously, the expectation is that any declaration and the register of interest is made before and prefaces a member's contribution in the chamber. But thank you. That concludes the portfolio questions on NHS recovery, health and social care. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.